Hello, everyone. On the occasion of International Children's Day, we have a discussion on one important topic, congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy, which happens in children. And the disease starts at birth only. So it would be very common, but still it happens in many children, and also in Indian scenario it happens, and the patient would have decreased vision in both eyes, and they by birth they'll have cloudy corneas, and it would be difficult for the children growth, and also it will be annoying for the parents. So today we have two very good corneal specialist who got a good experience in handling this condition. Dr. Amrita Mohanty, she is from Lalit Prasad Eye Institute, Bhubaneswar. She did her graduation and post-graduation in ophthalmology from Cuttack Medical College. Then she did a long-term fellowship in cornea and anti-segment from Lalit Prasad Eye Institute. At present, she is working as a consultant in Lalit Prasad Eye Institute, Bhubaneswar. And also we have Dr. Siddharthan, and he is a senior consultant in cornea and refractive surgery in Shankara Eye Hospital, Coimbatore. He has been trained in Arvind Eye Hospital, and having got trained and he has got most experience in doing the PKP as well as lamellar keratoplasty. And at first, Dr. Amrita would be talking on PKP in CHED. Later, Dr. Siddharthan would talk on lamellar keratoplasty in CHED. Now, over to Dr. Amrita.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Mallikarjun. So, is my slide visible, sir?
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay. So, hello everyone. I shall be talking about penetrating keratoplasty in cases of congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy, that is SHED. So, PK has been started by Sir Germ in 1905 and has been the gold standard for SHED patients for for centuries. It was only endothelial keratoplasty by Melis et al., where recently, which addresses to the endothelium, has been the gold standard for now, with or without desmid stripping. As cornea surgeon, we are well aware of the surgical technicalities involved in PK and the long-term suture-related complication, graft rejection, failure, or visual rehabilitation involved in peritoneal keratoplasty. So I shall be delineating the salient features in endothelial keratoplasty where PK is still a viable option. So coming to the preoperative factors, as we catch hold of this patient's pretty late, so the long-standing corneal edema can lead to corneal opacity, which is not amenable to endothelial keratoplasty, in which cases PK still remains the surgery of choice. As EK is a lamellar keratoplasty, we need a donor tissue, which is available as pre-cut tissues in the eye bank, which again depends on the availability. And also the other option is the manual dissection, where a surgeon's experience is needed. Coming to the intraoperative factors, perforation can happen, particularly in manual dissection, and sometimes graft can be expulsed while insertion, so which may lead to a lost graft or a damaged graft. In such cases, it warrants availability of a backup tissue. As we are dealing with cloudy corneas, corneal edema sometimes might not allow us for an endothelial keratoplasty, where penetrating keratoplasty remains the surgery of choice. We are dealing with pediatric cornea, which have a crowded anterior chamber and a crystalline clear lens. So in such cases, it depends on the patient selection and surgeon's experience in dealing in a relatively closed chamber, not to damage the intraocular structures, particularly lens. Although there has been no report of cataract following EK in SCED patients, but still the cataract rate in adult EK patients is as high as 40%. Coming to the post-operative factors, early is donor dislocation. So as we are dealing with pediatric patient, maintaining a post-operative supine position might be difficult in children. And again, if we need a repuppling, it has to be done under general anesthesia. Assessing pupillary block glaucoma in cases of pediatric patient might be difficult because most of them does not allow a slit lamp examination post-operatively. Again, bleeding because again it is a closed chamber surgery might be a post-operative complication which need to be managed medically or surgically depending on the severity. In late post-operative factors, edema can happen because of the non-attachment of the graft after rebubbling or graft rejection, although pretty lower in rate. Again, secondary glaucoma because of the pupillary block or the intraoperative manipulation can lead to secondary graft failure. As interface opacification, although rare, can happen, particularly in non-stripping cases. So comparing the outcomes of PK and endothelial keratoplasty, there is no head-to-head trial, but there are a few case series which report graft clarity obtained in PK is much more than that of the endothelial keratoplasty because of the persistent corneal haze or opacity in cases of EK. PK and EK have a comparable visual acuity, although astigmatism is pretty high in cases of PK. There is no RCT comparing the survival rate of PK and EK in pediatric population because of the relatively rare indications of SCED. But however, in adult cases, the 5-year survival rates of DSIC and PK in other cases of endothelial disorders has been same. And also we should keep in mind the success rate or graft survival of PK in infant is high in cases of SCED. That is, it can be up to 90%. So although in EK, we addresses the endothelium, which is the fault in SCED patient, but there are various indications of PK depending on the patient selection, surgeon's experience, and availability of donor tissue where PK stands to be a viable option. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Amrita. And I would request Dr. Siddharthan to proceed with his presentation.
Yes, Malik. I think she has to stop sharing the screen. Yeah. Screen is visible, Malik sir.
It's visible. It's clearly visible now.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Malik sir, for this opportunity to talk. I've been given the topic on this World Children's Day to talk on lamellar keratoplasty in SCED. I'm not going to disagree with what Dr. Amrita has told, but I would like to put my points in favor of lamellar keratoplasty. So all these has been discussed, but the main thing is that just for people who have not understood SCED, it's actually focalized or generalized absence of corneal endothelium. And there were two main types, SCED 1 and SCED 2, but SCED 1 is autosomal dominant and it's very rare. And SCED 2 is now what is what we regularly see. And most of them it's a prenatal onset. And the problem with SCED is that there's corneal edema and opacification because of the generalized or focalized absence of endothelium. So these are some pictures where you can see that the cornea is opacified. And as Dr. Amrita said, it's pretty difficult to do lamellar keratoplasty in these procedures, but I will explain to you that initially, even though the doing the surgery may be difficult, but the results of lamellar keratoplasty in longer run in these young patients is definitely an option. So here you can actually see the corneal thickness in an preoperative OCT is almost 843 microns in these patients. So the question is like, if you want to add another 300 to 400 microns, it becomes 1000 micron cornea. So what actually happens in a lamellar keratoplasty? So the question here is, when there is a problem only in the endothelium, so why do you want to do a full thickness graft in a CHED patient? As I told you, the problem is there only in the endothelium and the decimates layer. So my preference would be a decimate stripping endothelial keratoplasty, where we replace only a part of a portion of the stroma, and the decimates membrane endothelial keratoplasty, where we remove only the DM. So these are some of the videos I would like to show important things in endothelial keratoplasty. As Dr. Amrita was telling, pupillary block can be avoided by doing a PI. And this is after dissecting manually. And I think most of us are good in dissection, so I don't think we need to go for any pre-cut tissue. Most of us can prepare on our own. So after dissecting manually, using a taco fold, the graft is injected, and then it's positioned, and air is injected to form the IC. And even CHED, in DMAC in CHED, we have tried one or two cases. The problem is, we would prefer decimate stripping endothelial keratoplasty in these cases of CHED, because as the visibility is less. DMAC can be done fairly, cases which opacification is pretty less, we can do. So immediately you can see the post-operatively, you can see the thickness is 840 and we have added around another 400 microns, but this is immediate post-op. And you can see that around 6 months, you can see how much the compaction of the cornea. You can see the cornea has become very clear now, almost 500 microns, and this almost 300 microns, but you can see that how much the clarity has improved. And with this there are no sutures, and the patient gets a very good visual acuity with the selective replacement of only the endothelium. So the basic advantages is it's less invasive, particularly in children. You don't want to do a very invasive surgery. It's very less invasive, no sutures, very less graft rejection. And there's very faster rehabilitation, because it's very important to reduce amblyopia, because with PK, it takes a longer time for rehabilitation, particularly in children. It is important to have faster rehabilitation, and there's no induced astigmatism. And also it can be repeated when there is a graft failure or rejection. So when you come for a PK with EK, suture removal is pretty difficult, because a GA examination every time during suture removal is difficult, whereas in endothelial keratoplasty, even if you need to rebubble, you may need to only do a small one-time examination of a GA, and once it's attached, nothing to worry. And with opacification, as Dr. Amrita was telling, definitely opacification is a problem, but with the marking, if you mark the graft, the visibility will be there. It is repeatable and also visually almost equal to PK. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Amrita and Dr. Siddharthan, for your amazing presentations. And although both procedures have their own advantages and disadvantages, and both have their own place to play. Because in Indian scenario, most of the keratoplasties nowadays is done is penetrating keratoplasty, because of the training. Or it is the training of lamellar keratoplasty is not that much still advanced in Indian scenario, but still the PKP has a definitely role. And Dr. Amrita showed where we can consider PKP in chat. And also, she highlighted what are the difficulties in doing this laminar keratoplasty in CHED. And what I can say is, although there is a very advancement of lamellar keratoplasty, and which can be done in CHED, like DSEC and DMEC, as shown by Dr. Siddharthan, still it has some difficulties also. As he mentioned, visualization of the cornea, because of it will be very thick, and if the patient presents in the very late stage, there may be scarring also, and we need to remove the endothelium, and which would be very difficult to remove. Sometimes it may be not removed totally, and especially in DMEC, if you don't remove them completely, there might be some issues there. Still, many people are doing PKP with good results, and the only problem with the PKP, we have to follow up the patients frequently, because these are children. Any intervention we have to do, we have to do it under sedation or under general anesthesia. But still, if you do a PKP, patient can have a good vision. And also, they mentioned, both of them mentioned that initially, after lamellar keratoplasty, the corneal phase will be there for a longer time. And I read some articles where they did PKP in one eye and CHED lamellar keratoplasty in other eye. They found out that the corneal clarity did not improve as good as PKP in lamellar keratoplasty. Nevertheless, but these are the options we have, and both have to very good place in management of CHED, and both will give good results. And only the surgery and post-operative management is different. And with that, I would like to conclude this session. And once again, thank you, Dr. Amrita and Dr. Siddharthan, for your very nice presentation.